Knowing the ins and outs of your slicer of choice can mean stronger 3D prints, faster print times, less time spent in CAD customizing your models, and much, much more. And in this video, I'm going to share a handful of lesser known slicer settings that will help you take your 3D prints to the next level. Let's dive in. Before we dive into the actual settings, just a quick note. To the best of my knowledge, all of these settings are available in Cura, PrusaSlicer, Bambu Slicer, and so on. But personally, I've made the switch over to Orca Slicer, formerly known as the Soft Fever fork of Bambu Slicer, which itself is a fork of PrusaSlicer, which is a fork of Slick 3R. Whatever, you get the idea. Whatever slicer you're using, you should be able to find these settings, though they may be named just a little bit differently. If you can't find them quickly, just remember that your slicer has a search feature. I'm sorry, but this video would be way too long if I stopped to show how to navigate to each feature in every slicer out there. Oh, and if you haven't tried out Orca Slicer yet, you really should, because as you're going to see in this video, it is really slick. No pun intended, and it's definitely worth checking out. Especially if you want to be able to monitor your printer in your slicer without needing to go to a separate browser window. Oh, and I know that some of you may already know about a few of these, so feel free to use the chapters below to jump around. All right, let's get into the settings, shall we? First things first, let's start with one of the more practical ones and one that I use literally all the time. This feature allows you to determine at what threshold your slicer will switch from sparse infill like gyroid or grid to solid infill. And this is great because on many models with smaller details or limbs, you may want those weaker areas to be completely filled in without having to up the perimeters on the entire model. I use this a lot on my own Bitcoin art statuettes, especially my Bitcoin bull, to make the narrowest parts of the legs and the thin tail sturdier. This has made it much easier to ship them around the world without damage. Speaking of wanting to make specific areas stronger, many of you probably already know about modifier areas, but basically they allow you to add any shape or even another object to your model and then modify that area of the primary model accordingly. For example, you could increase perimeters only for that area, increase infill, remove top and bottom layers, do a different infill type, and much, much more. This is a great way to add strength, save material, add mouse ears for bed adhesion. There are so many ways that you can use this, and it's super valuable if you don't want to apply those changes to the entire model. While we're talking about modifiers, I do have to mention one that you probably know, but for those of you who are newer and don't, it's a must. In the same way that you can use modifiers to change settings in certain areas, you can also use negative volume modifiers to modify a model. Wow, say that three times fast. Don't let the fancy terminology fool you though. A negative volume modifier is just a way to cut out the difference between one shape and another. This can be used to remove parts of a model that you don't want, deboss logos or symbols into your model, cut holes into something that doesn't have them, or tons of other uses. This is especially useful if you aren't yet very confident in CAD software. So that's adding holes, but what if you want to remove them? Not to worry, because there's a slicer feature for that. Close holes, which is a drop-down option under slicing mode. This is the one that I actually discovered by accident, and I spent a long while trying to figure out why my holes weren't showing up after slicing. Basically, it gets the slicer to automatically close up the XY holes in your model. Now, you might wonder why you need that, but I found it to come in handy for a lot of models that may have, for example, screw holes, but which I prefer to mount with a command strip, for example. Instead of fixing the model in CAD or having an ugly hole that you don't need, you can just click one dropdown and the holes are gone. Okay, we've added holes, removed them, but what about compensating for them? Allow me to explain. One of the challenges with 3D printing is that the printer will simplify line paths, especially for round objects, which can cause things like holes to be too tight. This was particularly problematic for me when I tried to assemble the popular bamboo spool winder that everyone's been printing. Fortunately, you don't need to resort to filing your holes. Get your heads out of the gutter, guys. Or modifying the models in CAD, because you can instead use XY hole compensation. What this does is basically widen your holes by the specified amount before slicing them. I've used this feature to add a little bit of extra tolerance in models, and it saves so much time, frustration, and broken prints. Speaking of saving time and frustration, now's a great time to thank this video's sponsor, PCBWay. As I'm sure you know, PCBWay offers incredible prices on custom PCBs, plus fantastic sign-on bonuses, but did you know that they also do custom sheet metal fabrication, injection molding, CNC machining, metal 3D printing, and like half a dozen other things? So whatever project it is you're working on, if you're looking for a great fabrication service to help you add functionality or quality from one piece to 1,000, PCBWay helps you save money and time. Visit the link in the description below to support the channel, and thanks again to PCBWay for being this channel's longest standing sponsor. Okay, let's get back into the video. Speaking of saving time and effort, here's one that I would hope most of you already know, but which for some reason isn't enabled by default on any of the print profiles that I've seen. Combine Infill allows you to only print infill every 2 or 3 layers instead of every single one. This will mean thicker layer lines for the infill, but since nobody sees the inside of your model, it means that you can save a ton of time on printing without sacrificing aesthetics, which is a great segue into... Here's one that I'm always surprised people don't use more. You may not realize it, but certain parts of your models simply don't need small layer heights to look great. Conversely, other parts, such as spheres, need incredibly tiny layer heights to look even decent. So why not save time here where it's not needed and invest that time where it is? That's where variable layer heights come into play. You simply specify the trade-off that you want on a continuum between speed and quality, and the slicer will auto-calculate the necessary layer heights based on the geometry of your model. You may just find that major swaths of your model don't need anything more than 0.2 millimeter, and that's time that you can save or better use elsewhere. One such elsewhere is with the use of ironing. Ironing is a practice whereby your nozzle is dragged over a completed layer extremely slowly against the grain of the previous pass. While this happens, a very small amount of filament is extruded to fill in the remaining gaps. I'll be honest, ironing doesn't lead to a picture-perfect surface. It takes quite a long time, and if it's not dialed in, it can even make your surface look worse by scraping material off to the edges. So if you need a surface to look perfect, it is better to have that side face the build plate or sand it. However, if that's not an option and or you want the top of your model to look just as good as possible, then definitely check out ironing because it beats sanding your models by hand. Here's one that I've only recently begun using more, the cut feature. Many of you know that you can cut a model by sinking it into the build plate. But recent versions of PrusaSlicer and its derivatives also offer the ability to actually cut a model on any axis at any angle with the option of keeping one or both of the resulting cuts. This is super useful and frankly easier to do in the slicer than even the easiest to use of CAD programs. In case you haven't noticed, I'm incredibly impatient, and sometimes when I'm working on a project such as my honeycomb storage wall, link up here, I want to install the pieces as quickly as possible. Fortunately, I discovered Complete Individual Objects, a feature which will print one object at a time before moving on to the next. In order to use this, you'll need a few things. First, you'll need models that are low enough to not cause collisions when the print head moves on to the next model. Second, you'll need your slicer to know the actual clearance of the print head so that it can accurately predict any collisions. And third, you'll need to space out your models enough so that the collisions don't actually occur. Fortunately, all of this is either automatic for popular printers where the software already knows the print head size, or easy enough to configure in your slicer. Just please do me a favor and pause the printer before you reach in to snap off the parts. While we're on the topic of printing things one by one, let's talk about configuring them one by one as well. What if, for example, you have a few different objects that you need to print, but you want to have 5 perimeters and 10% infill, and another one to have 50% infill in just one perimeter? You could, of course, use modifier shapes, but that's slow. Instead, you can actually modify settings per object. Now, this used to be somewhat annoying and confusing in PrusaSlicer with a bunch of right-clicking and modifiers added into the object view that you'd then need to go down and click to see. But in Orca Slicer, it's actually really cleverly done. Simply right-click the object, hit Edit in the parameter table, and you can see and modify all of your parameters for all of your objects in one quick view. Clever, right? So there you have it, 12 of my all-time favorite slicer settings for getting more out of your 3D printer, saving time, strengthening prints, and so on. I hope you really enjoyed this video, and if you learned something, then please let me know by smashing that like or subscribe button or dropping a comment below. Thanks for watching, and a special thanks to all of my Patreon supporters, and I'll see all of you on the next layer.